wherever you turn around, it's a sea. It's endless, raging sea.
Christ against Satan, good against evil. We're about to discover the last deception of Earth's history.
But there is no way out.
The entire universe is involved.
Hello to everyone. It is an honor to welcome you to another presentation of the Central California Conference Biblical Symposium on Final Events. What an awesome time to be alive and to experience things that we know are to take place in the final days of Earth's history. We feel that the time is now to understand what's next. We have biblical scholars from all over the world who are presenting deep truths of prophecy. This is no time to fear. This is no time to panic. This is no time to grow restless. Instead, it is time to draw near to our powerful God who is
come by every day. These are top professors teaching us wonderful things. So please invite your friends and have them join us. We would be delighted to have them join us. For more information that perhaps you have forgotten or would like to share with people, I do remind you that it is all on our website and we have a page specifically for this Final Events Symposium. And you can find that page at www.centralcaliforniaadventist.com/What's Next. We will now have a wonderful panel discussion. And if you have questions that perhaps they're not discussing, or questions on anything else you've heard during the symposium, feel free to comment. We will do our best to engage with you, and we would certainly love to pray with you as well. We do remind you that this is a symposium. It is not a debate, and so we ask that we don't get controversial. We just want to connect with you in a friendly way. This morning, we are privileged to listen to a panel discussion on the Sabbath, taking it from a totally different perspective and sharing what the Sabbath means during the final events and looking at it from different perspectives. The moderator for this panel discussion will be Dr. Daniel Gouveia.
Thank you so much, Pierre. What an exciting opportunity to have a week to discuss themes that are so important for God's people in these last days of Earth's history. Seventh-day Adventist Christians have long believed that God has established the seventh-day Sabbath rest at creation when he blessed and sanctified this holy day. We believe that the commandment to rest on the seventh day precedes the giving of the Ten Commandments. We don't find any Bible evidence for the argument that we are to rest on Sunday. The Bible does teach that Jesus is the eternal Word of God who created the heavens and the earth. The one who, in the beginning, rested on the seventh-day Sabbath. And Jesus Christ is the same yesterday, today, and forever. The same God who rested on the Sabbath when he created us, rested on the Sabbath when he saved us. He came back to life on the first day of the week after resting on the Sabbath in the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. We believe the seventh-day Sabbath rest is a part of the moral law of God and that this law is still valid. We see obedience to the law as an expression of love for God and for other human beings. This obedience is the fruit of being saved by the grace of God and never a means to obtain salvation. We believe the last day people of God on earth will be a Christian people. They have faith in Jesus, and they keep all the Ten Commandments of God out of love. We believe that Christ was persecuted for restoring the true meaning of the Sabbath, and in the last days, his people will also be persecuted for restoring true worship. Satan will influence religious and political powers to form an alliance that will use force to make people worship in a way that is contrary to God's law. Those who refuse to worship the beast and its image will be persecuted. We believe the Seventh-day Adventist Church was born out of a great disappointment, originated by the Millerite movement and connected with the prophecies of the little book of Daniel, as revealed in the 10th chapter of Revelation. This church was called into existence by God to preach a special, grace-filled end-time message in all the world. We believe this message is the everlasting gospel, as depicted in the three angels' messages found in Revelation 14. In the first of these three messages, there is a call to worship God as the Creator, with language that greatly resembles the language of the fourth commandment of God's moral law. The movement, symbolized by this angel, works as a true prophet, a true Elijah, calling people to worship the true God and counteracting the work of the false Elijah, the false prophet of Revelation. We believe that the three angels' messages are to be proclaimed in all the world in the end times, and that before the mark of the beast is set up, everyone on earth will have the opportunity to examine the biblical arguments in favor of the seventh-day Sabbath rest. Sunday keeping will only become the mark of the beast when earthly governments, influenced by religious forces, enact national Sunday laws. These laws will cast an economic restraint upon God's people. But we do not believe that Christian believers that presently go to church on Sunday have the mark of the beast or are in any way false Christians. On the contrary, we know that most of God's people are now still in these churches. Faithful men and women will hear the last message of mercy proclaimed by the remnant people of God. Under the mighty outpouring of the Holy Spirit, depicted in the Bible as the latter rain, seeing the fulfillment of prophecy and hearing the voice of Jesus calling them, God's children in all nations will embrace the true everlasting gospel before the end of probation. They will come out of Babylon. It is then that, in the midst of dramatic worldwide events, Jesus, our Lord and Savior, will come to take us home. Join me now as I discuss this topic with Pastor Sandy Colon and Pastor David Dean so that we can better understand this special day, the seventh-day Sabbath. Sandy, David, thank you so much for joining me again for another panel discussion on this Sabbath morning. And today we are talking about the Sabbath, about this important truth, biblical truth, for us as Christians and Seventh-day Adventists, and that we do tie in with last day events. So I would like to invite Sandy. Can you pray for us, please, so that the Holy Spirit may guide our conversation?
Of course. Dear Father in heaven, God, we're talking about your Sabbath, something that you created to be a joy for you and for us together. And so we want to come to you humbly. We ask for the Holy Spirit to grant us a greater understanding, Lord, to shake from us the things that we are planted in that we think that we know, so that we can know what you want us to know, Lord. We give you permission to do this in us, open our minds to new facets to this beautiful truth. We pray for your glory in Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you, Sandy, so much. Yes, we do need the Holy Spirit to guide us to new, exciting truths in the Word of God. And David, as we talk about the Sabbath, starting at the beginning, the Bible tells us that after the creation week, after creating the world in six literal days, God rested on the seventh day, mm-hmm. and the Bible says that he blessed and sanctified that day. What does that mean? How is this day any different from the other days of the week?
That's a big question and really might be an inexhaustible one, but I think we can try to, shed some light on that. I think when we look at the scripture, especially in Genesis, where we see the inception and the beginning of the Sabbath, we recognize that God actually, in his reasoning, says that he blessed it and sanctified it because he's the one that rested on it. And he's basically telling us that he did that as an example. And if we look at the words themselves, it shows us that God is putting his favor, his extra special, unction upon the Sabbath. He's setting it aside for a very holy and a sacred use. And it's not like the other 6 days are not good. As a matter of fact, at the end of those first 6 days, God said that it was very good. So the Sunday through Friday, those days are good, but God put the Sabbath in a preeminent and a prominent position. He said that this is the best day, and obviously because God wanted to come together with humanity, he wanted humanity to rest as he rested physically, but I think it goes a little bit, deeper than that. I think when we look at the Sabbath and the rest of the 6 days, the seventh one being most special, but not taking away from the other six, I think of Jesus. Who is the Son of God, but so are we. We are the sons and daughters of God, but Jesus being prominent, he's preeminent. He's the one that stands above all other sons of God. Mm-hmm. And it's through Jesus that we all find a blessing, and we also find sanctification. Mm-hmm. So God tells us in Exodus, he also says this in Ezekiel, that basically that, the Sabbath was given to us that we might know that he is the Lord God who mm-hmm. sanctifies us. So I think what God is trying to tell us is that in and through Jesus Christ, he wants to do the exact same thing to us that he did to the Sabbath. Bless us, sanctify us, and again, he does this through his Son, and he does this through the Sabbath that we might know that he is the one who sets us apart, who puts his favor upon us for his goodness, for his glory, for his honor, and for our salvation.
Amen. That's wonderful, beautiful, and tying the Sabbath with Jesus is so important, and we will get to that in maybe just a few minutes. But Sandy, do you have any things that you would like to add to this idea that God blessed and sanctified the seventh day?
Yeah, I love the point that David brought out about that it also encompasses the sanctification of us mm-hmm. in that day, and that it's, God's work that we rest in that. It's such a great picture. God created all, we just read in Genesis, you read that part, he creates everything. And in his creation, he created cycles to everything in life. There's the evening and then the mm-hmm. morning. There's, we have the seasons, we have all these cycles, and he creates the weekly cycle for us. And he, as David said, he models for us that times of rest in these cycles are very important mm-hmm. and they actually play a part of our sanctification. Without that rest, we don't recover enough. Anyone knows if you get too tired,
yes.
you, as they say, lose your Christian experience, right? And yeah. sometimes I've heard the best thing you can do is take a nap, right?
Yeah.
So rest is very important in that cycle of rest. But also, we may look back at creation and say, well, did they get tired like we do in a world without sin? Even if they didn't get that kind of tired, it's this change of pace where we come together and celebrate in communion, in a deeper communion with God and with one another. Mm-hmm. And that's very precious and so important to all of us to have those moments of celebration together. If we think back through our life, it's the times that we stop and celebrate with one another that we create some of our most beautiful memories and our greatest connectivity, and that builds love. And so I think all of that also plays into this day being set apart and being, you know, consecrated for all this, these reasons that it's very special and important for us to remember it.
Definitely. I like that idea, that notion that God has set aside a moment in time for us to come closer to Him, to just build our relationship and our intimacy with Him, and to be restored and revived, since He is the source of life and energy and love in all the universe. Also, when I think about, you know, the fact that God blessed and sanctified the seventh day, I like to think about these notions of blessing and sanctification in the Bible with two episodes. First of all, I remember when God and Jacob were wrestling during a night in Genesis 32. It says that God blessed Jacob that night. And when you read that chapter and that passage specifically, it says that God changed his name. And we know that in the Bible, the name is basically attached to or connected with or actually is a symbol of the character of a person, of an individual. So Jacob, from being a deceiver, he started being somebody that was fighting with God and overcoming by the grace of God. So when I think that God has blessed the seventh day, it's like God has changed the character of that day. It's not an ordinary day like the other days. And like David said, all the days are good and all the days, you know, are wonderful days to worship God and love God. But the seventh day is just special because God blessed it and changed it in such a way that it's now better than the other day. So, yeah. And about sanctification, I heard a sermon once, or a Bible class actually, by a theologian that was linking it to Exodus chapter 3. And I thought the idea so fascinating that when Moses had an encounter with God in the burning bush, God told him to take the sandals off his feet because that was a holy ground, a holy piece of ground. And I normally like to ask in my churches or in the church that I'm currently pastoring, why was that place so holy? Why was that place different from any other place? And people normally say, well, because God was there. And I like to ask, isn't God omnipresent? God is everywhere. Why isn't every place holy? And of course, the answer is because God had chosen that specific place to have a special encounter with Moses. And I believe that God has chosen this specific day, the seventh day, to have a special encounter with us. That's why today is holy. That's why God sanctified it. Like David said, just consecrated to a special purpose. So what a blessing. God has blessed and sanctified the seventh day. He has given it to us. Now, when we continue reading the Bible, we find the Sabbath day again, especially in the Ten Commandments. We find it elsewhere, but we find it in the Ten Commandments, and we see that the Sabbath commandment, the fourth commandment, is the longest of the Ten Commandments, and it goes into a lot of detail. But when we link it to what Jesus has taught us to do in Matthew chapter 5, for instance, in the Sermon on the Mount, Jesus quoted some of the commandments of the moral law, and he showed his disciples that he wanted them to go beyond just the letter of the law. Sandy, how can we go just beyond the letter of the law with the Sabbath commandment?
Well, you know, we often point to that great section in the Gospel of Matthew where Jesus teaches that, you know, he's asked, what is the greatest law? And he says, love your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind, and love your neighbor as yourself. On these two hang all the law and the prophets. So we often point there, and we see this great principle of love being behind it. But sometimes we don't recognize that he's actually quoting from the Old Testament. Some people will say, well, the Old Testament was law and the New Testament is love. Mm-hmm. That is not what Jesus is saying. He's quoting, love was always the law. Mm-hmm. And I just also want to point out, some people in the world want to say that Jesus was kind of borrowing this from, you know, the ancients who believed in love your brother and stuff. But he got it from his own Hebrew roots, from himself, really, because he's the one who gave it.
Yes.
But it's there in, you know, Leviticus and in Deuteronomy. We read actually those words, love God and love others. Mm-hmm. And so I think, you know, thinking of the disciples as Hebrews and their history and their past as Jesus was teaching this, what practical things was he teaching them about love? What does that look like? And I feel like if we take Exodus 20 and where we find, you know, where we usually turn to look at the Ten Commandments, and then Exodus 31, which David referred to, where it talks about, in Exodus 20, it talks about he sanctified the day. In Exodus 31, it says, remember it because he's also sanctifying us. And just a little caveat there is that sometimes we think after Exodus 22 that he got the commandments and he walked down from the mountain because we see Moses then talking to the people. But just like in Genesis and the creation story, it's not exactly linear. Mm-hmm. It's sort of layered. Like, I told you this story, now I'm going to tell you it in a different way, or I'm going to add more to it.
Yes.
The same thing is happening in Exodus. Mm-hmm. So God actually repeats more about the Sabbath in verse 31. And then at the end of repeating the Sabbath, we see Moses coming down with the tablets of stone. So it's repeated again, and I just, you know, that shows how special it is. And then if we take Exodus 20, Exodus 31, and then Deuteronomy 5, where the commandments are repeated again by Moses before the children of Israel go into the promised land. If we lay them all over the top of each other, we start to see real practical principles of this loving God and loving others. And so just to quickly pull some of those out, obviously the first one is to remember who we're worshiping, who to love is the Creator God. He is the Creator and both the Recreator. He is the one who is doing the work in us. That should make the Sabbath more restful if we love him for all that he's doing. It's super important to remember that, or we think we work at keeping the Sabbath rather than resting in the one who's doing the work in us, right?
Yes.
So worshiping the Creator, remembering that sanctification of the day and us is a work of him, that's common in there. Mm-hmm. This picture of it being a sign, remembering that it's a sign between us, and that goes back to what's repeated throughout the Bible. God says, I will call you my people and I will be your God. That real communion with God, all this reflects a loving God. Mm-hmm. But there's a lot in the Sabbath that is about loving people. Mm-hmm. Because it talks about, you don't just rest yourself. Mm-hmm. Help others around you rest.
Yes.
Even strangers. And so we think, and sometimes we just think, well, that just means don't let anybody do any, you know, what we define as work. But there's more to it. Mm-hmm. Because These laws were set in the framework when both in Exodus 20 and Deuteronomy 5 were laid out with God saying, I'm the one who brought you out of bondage in Egypt. And in Deuteronomy 5, it says, don't forget that I brought you in the commandment. Remember it because you were brought out of bondage. Mm-hmm. And I think that this is saying, not only to remember our own freedom, but it talks about social justice. Hmm. It talks about having compassion for anyone who's oppressed and the importance of giving rest to that oppression. Hmm. That is actually part of this principle of love. I think God has wanted to teach us all the way along and was teaching the disciples in his time here, mm-hmm. in the body of Jesus Christ.
Yes, that's such a beautiful thought, that the Sabbath is a day of liberation, that we should really strive to help others to have that same rest, and not only physical rest, but spiritual rest, like you mentioned. Definitely. David, what do you have to say about the fourth commandment?
Yeah, I want to just just say that's amazing and a very powerful point. And really many powerful points that mm-hmm. Sandy brought out, especially linking the letter of the law of the Sabbath with the love and the character of God, which is absolutely vital if we're going to fully understand, comprehend, and even practice the Sabbath the way that God intended. I think Paul said that the letter kills, you know,
yes.
And that if we're just looking at the mere letter of the law, which of course we sometimes attempt to, you know, abide by, it not only kills us because it separates us from God, it makes us think that we can actually be saved on our own, which we absolutely cannot, but also sometimes leads us to kill others. Going into that comment about justice, if we're not focusing on what the Sabbath was meant to be and what we can do for others on that day, then essentially even not helping others or refreshing others or giving others rest leads to their death, not only maybe even physical death, but possibly even their eternal life being taken away from them or not given to them because they never found that rest that really, really only resides in Jesus Christ. But another thing that maybe I would add in regard to how we can go beyond the letter and look at this in the way of the Spirit is the fact that laws, especially in our day and age, maybe when we're growing up, you think of laws as rules and regulations and orders and things that you don't really want to do, but you have to do. You know, you're obligated to
yes.
have to do something about what you're commanded, depending on who that authority figure is. And so I think sometimes we approach God the same way. We see the letter and we just try to accomplish it, try to go for it. And I think what God wants us to see when it comes to His law, that really all of His laws, and I think most man-made laws, are there for our benefit. Mm-hmm. They're there for our good. They're given so that we can live free, so that we can be in a society that functions well, so there's order and not chaos. And that also tells us that the law then is something that gives us freedom. It gives us liberty. Now someone would say, well, the law actually is a restriction on my freedom. But if you think about it from the perspective of all of us driving on the freeway, let's say all three of us are cruising down the, you know, down the road in our different vehicles, mm-hmm. and there are no laws, no lines, no speed limit. Mm-hmm. I can do whatever I want to do. No infringement on my freedom, right? But it allows me to now infringe on your freedom. Mm-hmm. So I can run over my, you know, imaginary line into your line. I can cut you off. Mm-hmm. I can go as fast as I want. I can stop immediately and cause you to have to pump on your brakes, hopefully, and get out of the way. You know, so basically, even if we think my rights are being infringed upon, my freedom, but the laws are given so that we don't infringe upon the freedom that others have.
Exactly.
And so that society or God's way does not become anarchy and does not fall into chaos. Mm-hmm. So we find that law gives liberty and it gives life and it gives freedom. And the Bible tells us in, I believe it's at the end of, I don't want to get this wrong, but basically 2 Corinthians chapter 3, I think it's verse 18, where it says that where the Spirit of the Lord is, there mm-hmm. is liberty.
Yes.
So when we find the true spirit of the law, mm-hmm. we'll find freedom, mm-hmm. we'll find liberty, not only for ourselves, but we'll be able to see that laws are really also not only given for liberty, but also for community mm-hmm. and for unity. So then we're not only thinking about how can I benefit from this or how are my rights being infringed upon, but how can I now join community so that everyone together has freedom within the limits of the law, within the boundary of the law. So in my own life, I try to, you know, adopt that and remember that, go beyond the letter and find out what is the Spirit really trying to say to help us to live the Sabbath the way that Jesus did.
Oh, yes. Yeah. And I love the ideas that you both shared. I mean, they're so powerful. Just to tie into that idea of liberty, James chapter 2 tells us, and James was quoting the Ten Commandments, that the Ten Commandments is basically a law of liberty. God rescued the people of Israel from Egypt, and He gave them the law of free citizens of His kingdom, the laws that they were to abide by if they were truly free in Him. And I do believe that the Sabbath commandment is no exception. People nowadays are slaves of work, and, you know, we Seventh-day Adventists, we have these truths, and we think that sometimes we may be tempted to think that we're better than others because we know what the true day to worship is. However, we also fall into the same temptation of being slaves of work. We need to rest. We are not machines. We cannot, you know, just continue working without stopping. We need to rest and to pause and to think about our Creator. I love the fact that the fourth commandment starts with the word remember. And we normally say, and I think it's true, that most people forget the only commandment that God said to remember. And I also, I It's wonderful that Sandy brought up the fact that all those chapters after Exodus 20, they were also happening as God was interacting with Moses after he wrote the Ten Commandments with his finger. And right before God places the two tablets of stone in the hands of Moses in Exodus 31, we are told that God reminds him of one commandment, and that is the Sabbath commandment. Like, God could have underlined any other commandment, and he underlines the Sabbath commandment. So definitely this is very, very precious to the heart of God. He really wants us to rest in him, not only physically, but spiritually. And when we come to the New Testament, we find Jesus visiting the synagogues every Sabbath. He would go to the synagogue. That was his custom. But still, he was accused of breaking the Sabbath. Jesus was actually persecuted. And if you read Matthew chapter 12, verse 14, actually tells us that they were planning the death of Jesus. They were planning on killing Jesus because he was performing healing miracles on the Sabbath day. David, what did Jesus truly taught about the Sabbath, and why is it so important for us today?
You know, Jesus, the first thing I think about with Jesus is that he's rather revolutionary, and we don't sometimes like to use that kind of a word. It's a little too sharp for us today, but I think if Jesus were here in this day and age, we would have a lot to say about some of the things that he did. We would still probably call him a revolutionary and a maverick, and we probably get upset at him because what the other thing that Jesus is doing here, besides I agree with the fact that he would go to the synagogue on the Sabbath, so if we want to learn from that, it means on a weekly basis, as we can, recognizing especially we're in the middle of a pandemic, especially here in California, though there's a lot of, you know, regulations and restrictions when it comes to actually attending worship in person in some cases. But as much as we can, when we can, we should follow the example of Jesus and find ourselves right there in church, in community, in worship, connecting with others, and not just only enjoying the digital and virtual experience, unless that's the only thing a person can do, which we don't, you know, knock that. I encourage that. But at the same time, getting together with like-minded believers. Mm-hmm. And then I'll add in this also that Jesus, when he was there, he was serving. You find him speaking on one occasion in his hometown. You also find him serving, ministering to people who were there in the synagogue, casting a demon out of one man, helping a woman who's, you know, bent over, mm-hmm. Helping a guy that had a withered hand. And so we find that Christ consistently served. He didn't just attend. He wasn't just a spectator, mm-hmm. But he was there actually looking for opportunities to serve. But looking at this revolutionary idea about Jesus, that he intentionally looked for moments to challenge the traditions and the customs of the people. Mm-hmm. And I don't want to give it.